For the first time in over a decade, you can now actually earn interest on your cash. Maybe not in a bank savings account, because banks haven't caught on that they need to pay savers interest. But there's other places you can put your cash safely to earn up to 5% per year. Today, we're going to get into how you can do that and how you should be investing with Jason Brady. He is the president and CEO of Thornburg Asset Management. They manage over $40 billion. Join me, Ed D'Agostino, as we catch up with Jason Brady. Hey, Jason, it's good to see you again. It's been a while.
It's great to be here, Ed.
Jason, I was reading Thornburg's outlook for 2023, and your section in particular struck me because you said that in many ways, the market has returned to normal. I paused reading that and I thought, ooh, for a lot of people, I bet this doesn't feel normal. I bet it feels painful. So I'm curious what you mean by normal. How are you measuring that?
I think that what we saw for quite some period of time, to include with the pandemic response, was obviously very easy monetary policy in order to get us through some uncertain times. And we really struggled to get away from that, obviously, after the financial crisis. I'm struck even before we got the pandemic response, the Fed was actually cutting rates through 2019. So we were in a period of very low rates, obviously a period ultimately of very high equity valuations, particularly in the U.S., particularly for tech. And 2022 was really a story about how, one, those two things are relatively correlated, at least at extreme levels. And two, as we get back to essentially some real cost of money, positive real returns, for example, on treasuries or on interest-bearing stuff, that gets us back to an environment which is, frankly, pretty typical. We went in valuations in the U.S. from quite a ways above average to, you know, by the end of the year anyway, right around average. So to me, it's a normalization. And it speaks well to prospects for future returns.
Do you think that the last decade or so of such unusual activity by the Fed, such suppressing rates, did that kind of knock the business cycle off course? Like, do you think we'll get back now to a regular business cycle and a recessionary cycle?
It's a super interesting question. It's obviously been a really long time. I would tell you this. I think that the pandemic recession, it was clearly a recession, but from a business cycle standpoint, it was not typical. It was not really part of the business cycle. It was caused by a disease, and it was fixed, not necessarily by government response, but rather by a vaccine. So that was a little bit weird one. I would say that 2016 was actually something of a real cycle, 15 into 16. So, yes, it's been unusual. Are we going to get back to a cycle? I would say, you know, honestly, from 08 to 16 with the European financial crisis in there, that was a real cycle. And then again, kind of 16 to, I would say, kind of now. So I think it's always been there in the background. It's just a question of what the Fed or policymakers' response has done in the context of elongating that or potentially deepening it or both.
So let's talk about the Fed a little bit. You know, we got another hike. Criticizing the Fed is sort of anyone in finance, it's their national pastime, right? Like, just everyone loves to criticize the Fed. I'm curious what your view is. Are they doing the right thing now? And should they keep hiking?
I think they're doing the right thing now. And I don't think they should keep hiking, at least not, say, to 6%. If they're talking about ongoing hikes, if they end up at 5.25 as a terminal rate or something like that, it kind of doesn't matter if it's 5 or 5.25 or 5.5, right? In fact, what they're trying to communicate now is that it's not so much the level or the pace, but rather how long they're going to be there. And they want to communicate they're going to be there for a long time. I think they got behind. They got embarrassed. They read the tea leaves wrong. They changed their reaction function very specifically, mostly as a result of what they had learned in 2008. But again, 2020 was not a typical kind of business cycle moment. 2008 was very financial. 2020 was, again, more of a global health crisis. So very different lessons to learn, and they reacted how they think they should have in 08. They did that in 2020 and with some really challenging results. So they fixed it. They fixed it dramatically. They did a bunch of really aggressive hikes to catch up. And now they've kind of caught up. No, I think they're doing the right thing at this point. I think they're communicating fairly clearly that they're going to be on hold for a while. The market doesn't believe them, though, and frankly, neither do I.
Oh, interesting. So that was going to be my next question. Do you think, like the market thinks, that there will be a rate cut in 23?
I do, but I think it's a question of why. So why do you think you're going to get cuts? I think it's because you're going to see real signs of a slowdown. You're going to see inflation falling or continuing to fall reasonably quickly, and the Fed. Remember, this is going to be 9-10 months from now. Is going to find themselves in a position where they're going to need to support the economy. It'll feel something like it did at the end of 2018. When in December, Powell was saying, hey, these QT is on autopilot, we're going to raise rates, we don't care about the markets. And, not very long afterwards, they completely switched tact. So you look at the history of the Fed, they don't stay on hold at a high level for very long because it's very hard to get it right when you're looking backwards at lagging indicator of inflation and lagging indicator of unemployment.
So Thornburg runs about $40 billion in assets, a lot of it in fixed income. And you personally are a portfolio manager. In addition to being the president and CEO, you run some book in fixed income. Where are you seeing opportunity right now in fixed income? What do you like?
So it's better than it was a year ago, but not as good as it was 3 or 4 months ago. And actually, you've seen some pretty dramatic moves from kind of 4.25-ish, not quite, down to about 3.5 today, for example, in the 10-year, or another way to look at that is almost 2% real yields on 10s, according to TIPS, to just above 1% now. So we're seeing some opportunity. The consumer's balance sheet still looks pretty good. You can get some really interesting, relatively short ABS, kind of 2 or 3 year ABS, very high quality AAA or something that we would call AAA in the context of rating agencies not having caught up to how the security has changed. You can get that in sort of the mid to high 6% range. I actually think investors are making a mistake of rolling T-bills too much right now. The real yields on offer are not amazing, but they really can provide some ballast to a portfolio. So I also run a multi-asset portfolio on a global basis, and it's been a long time since bonds have been able to provide both income and ballast. And today they can provide a bit of both.
In the equity markets, you're hearing a lot of people talk about non-US equities, mm-hmm. and also hearing a lot about emerging markets. So not just mm-hmm. Europe and developed world, but EM. Does that translate into the bond world as well?
Less. If you think about balance sheets that you can invest in fixed income, there's really only three, right? There's the balance sheets of countries, there's the balance sheets of companies, and there's the balance sheets of individuals. And right now, countries' balance sheets are pretty bad. If you look at equities are obviously care about the income statement mostly of companies. So those are in much better shape, but sovereign debt isn't that good. And a lot of the sovereign debt, a lot of the debt outside the US dollar, and certainly in emerging markets, tends to be focused on sovereigns or quasi-sovereigns. So not as good a picture. While the prices did adjust quite a bit in 2022, there's still some economic effects to be felt in some emerging markets with the lagging effect of Fed hikes. So some are ahead, but others have yet to feel some of those effects. So it's a little different in bond land than in equity land.
Well, let's look at a couple other sort of sectors in bond land.
Sure.
If I could ping you on, like, your thoughts on munis, for example. How do you feel about municipal bonds?
Credit quality is just fine. Again, that's the government balance sheet, but as opposed to sort of the federal government balance sheet, obviously you've got a variety of different balance sheets you can reference. I think the credit quality is still pretty good. There are some kind of high yield or subsectors of muni land, which are small, which aren't great, but by and large, not a lot to worry about there. Valuations are pretty are not as attractive as they have been in the past. Even though you've gotten a really interesting increase in yields, and if you tax adjust those yields, you get to some pretty nice places. Munis relative to treasuries aren't necessarily as attractive as they have been in the past, and so you really have to be squarely in a high tax bracket in order to love munis here. But it's not much of a credit story unless you get in some really ugly little niches.
So it sounds like you overall you feel pretty good about corporate balance sheets. Is that a fair statement?
I feel pretty good about public corporate balance sheets. You know, as we look at this cycle, and if I think the Fed's going to be cutting, I think they're going to be cutting because we're going to see a real slowdown. You know, typically that's when balance sheets deteriorate. Certainly it's when income statements deteriorate. You're seeing that in earnings now, a bit of a turning point. So, you know, in general, you say, hey, I'm a little cautious here. And indeed, corporate spreads in bonds are not that great. They're okay.
Yeah.
But I really think a lot of the bad behavior over the last cycle hasn't really been in public markets. It's really been more in private markets. And so as you look at where those repercussions for, you know, Fed rate hikes might go, it feels to me more in private markets away from sort of the big names that are referenced for public corporate bonds or public equities for that matter.
Do you think there will be an opportunity coming in distressed debt?
I do. I do. I think it's hard to get the timing exactly right, which is always the challenge for distressed debt investors. I can tell you, I have often bought the bottom in a particular bond or in a market, but I have never only bought the bottom, Ed. It's you sort of buy it and then it goes lower and you buy it, it goes lower and you buy it, it goes lower. And so today we're in an environment where prices are down. So to get a little kind of fixed income voodoo on you, it's the convexity profile is good. Bonds that were issued at par, say they're trading at 85 today or 80. If you have a recovery value at 40, you have a much smaller distance from par to 40. That's larger. 85 to 40 is less. So there's actually a nice cushion in a lot of cases. So there is some benefit to lower prices, even if it's just from yields. But like I said, spreads aren't that interesting. And I think what you're going to see is some weaker earnings on income statements flow through to weaker balance sheets, flow through to some distress in corporate America. But again, more on the private side than on the public side.
I want to come back to something that you said at the beginning of our discussion, where you said that you thought individual investors maybe are doing too much rolling of T-bills right now. Mm-hmm. And I'll just raise my hand and say, I might be that guy.
You're not alone.
I mean, I've been enjoying seeing interest after how many years of not being able to earn any interest on your cash. And I've also been enjoying sitting on the sidelines with all the volatility in the equity markets. I'm obviously not 100% out, but I moved a bigger chunk than normal out of the equity markets before it took a hit.
Congratulations.
So, well, I think it was more dumb luck than anything, but
congratulations anyway.
Sometimes the more you study, the less you actually know. But I'm curious, like, so if you were, if that was your book, what would you be doing? What would you be moving more into 2 years, or where would you go?
The question always comes up when you have an inverted curve. Which is to say the front end of the yield curve is yielding more than the long end of the yield curve. And what you're always trying to balance is investment income or yields and reinvestment risk, right? So in theory, the 10-year is with a term premium with a little extra for locking your money up for longer. It's really just a series of 3-month or 6-month periods, right? And so the inverted yield curve assumes that you're going to see a fall in interest rates over some period of time. And as you look at the full curve, you can kind of graph out what that might look like. Because I think the Fed's going to be cutting rates, the yield that you're going to receive in the front end is going, in my view, is going to go away. And the market says that, too. It's just a question of how quickly. What I see investors doing is not so much making a mistake by having money in T-bills. You know, you should have a portion of your portfolio in cash. But rather, the money that they have as a longer duration, let's say, as a part of their ballast for their portfolio, they're putting in T-bills and they're taking on reinvestment risk. Generally, when you look at individual investors, their duration of their liabilities, the way they think about liquidity, it's generally about 3 or 4 years, right? And so in our view, investors should have a portfolio duration, if that's you're not using it for cash, of about 3 to 4 years. It's similar to people that hold cash, the opposite mistake where they say, hey, I'm going to need this money in 3 months, but let me go invest in the stock market because I'm going to make a lot of money on it. That's exactly the same mistake, but in reverse.
Sure. Interesting. No, that's a great perspective. I haven't heard that. Have you looked at some of the new, fairly new bond ETF products? Like there's a bond or ETF product that just invests in the on-the-run 3-month treasury, the 2-year and the 10-year. Any thoughts on those?
It's nice that investors have options for easy entry into a market that should be easy to enter, right? I mean, Treasury Direct is also an easy way to own treasuries. There's not a lot of barriers for investment in treasuries, which is great, actually. In general, one of my theses on the asset management industry is, you know, we used to think we were getting paid to navigate markets, but really there was a lot of premium and a lot of folks were getting paid just for access to markets. And as the price to access to markets has gotten much, much lower, it's exposed, hey, how much are you adding in the context of navigation? So I'm all in favor of the price of access being low, because in my view, hey, what my value add is that navigation. So,
right.
Yeah, I see that. I think it's interesting. It's valuable. There are definitely some great sort of low-cost ETFs there. On the flip side, one of the most active ETFs in fixed income and one where huge amounts of options are being written is HYG, high-yield ETF, the iShares high-yield referent. That's 50 basis points in expense. That's expensive. Wow. And it perennially underperforms because of bid-ask spreads of high yield, like dramatically. So there are markets where ETFs make a lot of sense. Large cap U.S. stocks, you know, very liquid treasuries, generally liquid fixed income, and there's markets where they make less sense. And it's for me, that's an important differentiation.
So I'm going to throw a curveball at you now.
All right.
We have a mutual friend, Jared Dillian,
mm-hmm.
and he told me that I should congratulate you on becoming a sommelier. I checked with your team, and they said, well, he's not actually a sommelier. He's a nerdier version of that. So what are they talking about?
That's a very accurate description. So always get your Jared knows a lot about me that I appreciate that he withholds most of it. So there's essentially two well-known tracks for wine education. One is the Court of Master Sommelier, and that obviously has a component of service, right? Hey, if you're a sommelier, you have to be able to serve the wine well, et cetera, et cetera. And that's what you see the movie made about. It's sort of a compelling movie. There's another track, which is called the WSET, the Wine and Spirits Education Trust. It's in the UK. That eschews the service portion. So, like, I don't need to know how to, you know, exactly pour a glass of wine, I can pretty much figure that out. But it adds on a bunch that's not just knowledge about wine, but also the business of wine. So that's what I've pursued. And I will say, I've passed a lot of tests and gotten several designations, but I've also failed a couple tests. So I'm not quite to the finish line, let's just say.
So when you get to the finish line, do you have a title?
I have a diploma in wine.
All right. Very cool. Very cool. Well, good luck with that. I am an amateur wine enthusiast. So, and I've been lucky enough to have dinner with you one night when you chose the wine and it was sublime. So I look forward to doing that again.
It's all about value, Ed. That's the key. That's why you get everybody can choose the one that everybody knows, but the education comes when you're trying to find value, just like in the markets.
Indeed. Jason Brady from Thornburg Asset Management. Good to see you, man. I really appreciate your time.
It's my pleasure, Ed. Thanks for having me.
If you liked the video, please hit the like button. And hey, if you didn't, that's fine. Put a thumbs down. Drop me a comment. Let me know what you think. And stick around. We'll have more content for you next week and every week thereafter.